Just kind of saw what he should wear, and wanted a sense of another time.
Yeah. With the snow in it, though.
Yeah, the snow in it, it would be better.
To sew somebody trapped in a place in time, you know, frozen there, stuck there, that wasn't even the exact reality of where that person was now, you know, like caught in a pattern of like a past life or something.
Will that fuck up the rings if you put the shit on the rings too?
No, it just
to the rings too.
It just wipes. Do you want to do this hand? Or are you gonna show?
No, I mean the snow and shit on the rings.
Inside?
Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know.
I don't want to. Well, if I put any glue on it, really that might be a problem. Yeah.
It was a lot of fun to do, and it was exactly what I wanted.
If it works, you know, if it transfers to film right, I mean, each individual scene will, but it's how the scenes hook together. It's gonna be important. Took a motherfucking long enough time to write it.
If it works, it's a, you know, like the first step towards bigger type of projects. Not necessarily meaning just for videos, you know, but if we really want to film, you know, something feature length, you know, this is our first try at it. Because, I mean, there's no, like, real rehearsals. You know, it's just, like, rehearse one take, go.
Wake up! It's time to play!
For me, it's a mind blower because I've never been on a full movie set or anything like that. This is really easy. I mean, they have a good concept of what we're doing. Working with this kind of budget, we want to make sure we get it right. Andy's great. This shredded plastic. This is really fun to breathe. We're back to work.
It's one of the first songs that we started playing as a band in the incarnation. And it really kind of put us across in the clubs.
Yeah, they like Welcome to the Jungle and stuff, but Don't Cry was like the most popular song.
As a matter of fact, it's like one of the only songs I remember from the old days, the club days, because it was like the only audible song because the amps were so loud. You get into a little club like the Troubadour and that's, you know, you couldn't really hear anything until they went to Don't Cry and you could kind of make something out there.
It was something we would have recorded on the first record, but
it never came out feeling just right.
Money was not allotted to do as much as we wanted to do, and we decided,
since it was our most successful song, to save it
for the next record. We didn't know it was going to be records.
She had the demo, and I was like, oh, wow, I'd really love to, you know, I'd really love to hear this at home in my own stereo. I said, you can take it. So I still have it.
Got it on this shitty-ass tape from someone who knew someone who knew someone.
It's been bootlegged. I mean, there's bootlegs I've heard, like, 12 generations, you know?
I used to play in a cover tune band in Indiana. And we used to cover the song Don't Cry because it was a song that no one back there knew. Everybody was into GNR, but these were songs that weren't on the Appetite album.
And it has Don't Cry in there, it has Heartbreak Hotel on there.
We didn't play it for 4 years. We just started playing it again, so it's real fresh to us again.
It's cool. I mean, anytime, like, anyone, because Shannon's a great guy, you know, he's a friend of mine.
I'm a redneck from Lafayette, Indiana. There's a few other rednecks around here from Indiana, I think, also.
What up?
There went one.
Anytime that you get an opportunity to play with someone that is a friend.
It was kind of an accident. It was kind of just a open mic night at the Record Plant in Hollywood.
We've added a lot of new life to it, and especially with Matt playing drums.
I was singing along with it. And I think, I don't know, I'm not sure how it came about, but Axel came in and Izzy said something, I think, to Axel that I was singing along with it. And Axel asked me if I knew the song. I said, yeah. So he had a couple background parts, he thought, to do it. And went in, I sang a couple background parts, and it sounded cool, and then he was like, well, fuck it, let's sing the whole song together.
It's great, yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, I played on it.
I do a lot of ooh-oohs. I do a lot of ooh-oohs not in the studio, as a matter of fact. No, that's Izzy.
It's kind of taken a new life, which is you know, cool.
He's a, you know, fabulous singer as well, so it's a pleasure, it's fun.
Is that it? That's it.
What my plan was, I was gonna sit there and I was gonna hold the steering wheel as casually as possible and ignore all her bitching. And she gets in the car and kicks my ass, and I have to defend myself at this point.
Yeah,
so it's developed into a real situation. Although she's really cool, and after we're done, everything's cool. But we're in the car, we're really fucking into it.
Me and Andy are looking over at each other going, Slash is acting.
It's not really acting, I can't act.
No, I just wanted to be able
to like, do it. Oh, okay. There's variety, those screams, where are they coming from?
Straight from the heart, baby.
Is it from the past or is it just from this moment?
Well, I think it's a little bit of both, psyching myself out and pondering up some things that have pissed me up in the past.
You guys loading up, please. Everybody else back? Drop that guy.
And it was funny because Morahan kept coming up to you.
Hey!
Or coming to me going, is she okay? Is she okay? And he kept coming up to you going, are you all right? Are you all right?
Just trying to get in the frame of mind.
I actually fucking started saying something back. You know?
I know it. I saw it.
So I was talking too much shit. Trying to defend yourself.
And, you know, and I'm trying to, watching these blows because they're coming out of nowhere, right? She's kicking around a few times. It's all right, though. It energizes the whole fucking scene. Yeah, I'm on to it. But she's getting me going because you know what I'm doing is I'm trying to follow the road. So I am concentrating just, and she's like freaking me out. And did you see the cigarette scene?
Yeah. It's pretty cool.
No, did I have?
It's in her eyes and she's just got this attitude and I was like, fucking, she is a bitch. I mean, she can do it, you know? Yeah, I know, she, no, I mean, but she's, I could just see it.
Gee, I wonder who that was.
Hey, Bridie, get your lazy over fucking Bridie. Ass up here.
I wonder if we should slip Slash's. Slash,
can you slide your seat back a little bit?
Come on, you greedy bitch, get up here!
No.
Lazy overpaid bitches on the set.
Thank you.
What are some of your guys' pet names for each other?
Fuck you.
Asshole, dickhead,
fucking pussy,
loser.
You ever met a 17-year-old like that?
No. No, I haven't. Except for, well.
Well.
Except for yesterday.
No. A long time ago. That's probably where this whole idea came from as far as me wanting to drive a blonde. You know, remember when we first came up with this?
Sure.
It's because my last girlfriend was, like, insane.
Right, Sabrina,
like Bomb, and maybe somebody over here goes, you know,
or someone turns and walks out too.
Somewhere over here looking at something going, you know what I mean? Okay, so then maybe like somebody over in here acting like they're shocked.
What do you think?
Hey, Gene.
Andy, you know, with everybody cheering, I said, why don't you have Sabrina, you know, looking bummed about it? And one guy in the band, maybe Dizzy, because Dizzy and Sabrina are together, you know? And, like, and since it's an angle, this angle, somebody over in this crowd, it's like, rather than everybody just, you know, because they have that going on, but, you know, you'd have a few people shot.
Yeah,
know,
that's good. Yeah, that's good, cool.
And Stephanie, your present girlfriend, sidles up to you in the piano bar, acting the way she's never acted to you.
That blew my mind.
And yet, as because an actor, we're getting into the things that are natural after what used to happen to you.
Yeah, and it made me like, you know, about Stephanie, it made me like.
And it shows up on the screen.
You know, and it freaked me out because she's never been that way.
Take it so hard now, and please don't take it so bad. I'll still be thinking of you. And the time.
So, do you think Warren Hewlett is one of the keys to your success?
No.
Do you know who wrote Don't Cry?
I was successful before fucking Warren Hewlett. Well, he's maybe the reason for my continued success.
We're gonna do a little word association, okay?
Okay.
You ready? Slash.
Brilliant.
Axel.
Brilliant.
Documentary crew.
I hate him.
Stephanie Seymour.
Brilliant.
Danette.
Brilliant.
Claire.
Brilliant.
Variety.
Both of them brilliant.
Okay, we've got a bunch of people. We have Slash, Stephanie, Axel, people who've never worked as actors before. Does it trip you out?
Yeah, I mean, last night when we did that scene with Stephanie, Axel, and Danette, who aren't, none of them are actors, and it was
really natural. Yeah, very really good.
You know, there's a lot of things that on the record that, and in past records, that people call my demon voice, or like when I go into certain moods, and that's the demon. So, kind of wanted to put that into an actual character and show it, and. You know, it's, I feel like it was a part of me. It's not easy being green. You know, everybody has their demons, you know, that they have to deal with, and most people don't, and you have to face these things.
Chuck, can you hop up for a second?
I get a light.
Thanks.
I got one. Sit the box down there.
One and three, yeah.
That's
there's a song we have, Perfect Crime, where it says, keep the demons down. You know, and it's like most people do that, you know, one form or another, try to keep everything down and not understand why they're certain ways or why they feel certain ways.
No kidding. It doesn't look the same.
Looking good,
miss. You don't look the same at all. You look completely different.
Oh, my God.
It's not really makeup, though.
It's not?
No, it was a chemical peel. It's also a bit to do with reincarnation, whether anyone believes in that or not.
You kind of come into yourself.
Yeah, we'll turn his pants off if we can.
Do you want to keep your hands?
It's the other way.
Oh, okay.
You know, because it's like finding it. Okay. This was like a part of me and going to have to come back again, and it's recognizing the light. And, you know, at first it's scared of it, and then you know, the second time it decides, hey, wait, I like this, this feels good, this is warmth, I haven't seen warmth in a long time. How much of the camera is shooting me?
No, it starts off the light, and then you see your hand, and then you see your hand, and it keeps coming
okay,
down.
It but it's not shooting from the waist down really here, is it?
Not from first shot, no. I was going to save the head to toe for when you walk away.
I just don't want to film my green dick.
So I was going to keep you in the back.
So this is how I'm doing the next leg of the tour.
So Daniel.
Naked and green.
I actually want to come down here, really.
My nose itches. It's also to symbolize if you didn't get it right, you get to try again, you know, or not get to try again. You might have to try again. You might get trapped somewhere. You might get trapped inside yourself. You might get... You know, in real life, you might get trapped inside something when you die. You know, I don't know. You know, I'm just in this life. I have no idea, you know, what's truth or what's not about things. I'm learning.
Axel, just put your hands in there, just walk through it. Then walk to that mark.
I kind of like this. I kind of like this a lot. I think this is the new me.
I was Lou Ferrigno's love child.
If you want to fuck with me, don't fuck with me.
I just would like to tell everyone in St. Louis
that I'm fucking green, so don't fuck with me.
Me and others like me will probably climb up through your intestines and eat the lining out of your stomachs.
Steps, alright?
Yes.
You come down the steps, she's there. Right. She's gonna have her head turned away from you, so you come, hey, she turns around to you and you try and kiss her.
Okay, so I think it would be very cool if like I went to try to kiss her and then she just like turned her head and it just goes poof.
It's more like, hey, man, you know, like, do you see what I mean? It'll just make us see you going to her, because otherwise you just get to her and you turn to her. So if you just put your hand out, it might be pretty cool.
And then I'm going to continue walking and I'll turn around and like go, what the fuck?
You know?
4 o'clock in the morning, Josh calls me, as usual, asking me could I play secretary for him. He and Axel were casting the video and they didn't want the girls to be scared away by going up to the Chateau Marmont and meeting Guns N' Roses. So they thought I could be a good front for them. There I was in my little Miss Moneypenny outfit, ushering 16-year-old models, which was not really something that I look forward to, but at the end of the day, they just decided that they wanted to use me. He was the sweetest of them all.
Really?
Yeah, he was very, very simple, very sweet, and just like really into it.
Wow. Ooh. Realism. Yeah.
It's my most favorite face in the world.
I didn't know you were going to swing that.
Guys, gotta be careful, that real bottle.
That's a real fucking bottle.
Yeah, I'm hanging here.
You have to stand even further back, I think. You have to cheat it. That.
Oh yeah, one more down there.
No, up there, but back against, further against the wall. Because yeah. What I want to see is...
You want to see, okay, I'm just going to like do a fucking piff, you know? Yeah, exactly. Like fuck you, you know?
Exactly.
Right? Eye protection. It's candy glass, but it shards.
Yeah, no, when we give them the safety guard, we're going to see them.
I've got them coming in.
Well, obviously, I mean, any impact, you're going to close your eyes. I'll close my eyes. Don't worry about it, man. I played baseball for 10 years. It's all right. Don't worry about it.
I say, here's what I'm here, and I'll turn around.
Andrew, can I get the...
He's throwing a bottle.
But look at me, right? As he's throwing a bottle.
I don't really want to throw it. I want to hit that, right? I'm not letting go until I hit that.
No, you want to throw it, and he's going to hit it.
You know, it's like, oh, more overhand, you know, like, swing. But look at me. All right. Looking at you, baby.
And action!
Where the fuck you going, asshole?
Yeah, nice one. I'm fucking...
I got to smash a bottle over Duff's guitar so I could get out all my aggressions on all those pop stars that had fucked me over.
Touch this. And look what I'm doing. Hey,
you know, he was so excited that we got it right and was like high-fiving me. And...
Okay. That was a double.
Thank you. You guys ready? Alright, Duff, who
Who wrote Don't Cry?
I did.
I'm back.
It says 1990 is because
on the tombstone,
you know, 1990 was a very, you know, very suicidal year. You know, some things were really good, and then with the marriage not working and stuff like that, it just made me realize all kinds of things haven't ever really worked, you know, and I gotta get through it and figure out why so many things continually go wrong.
When you see the headstone, your headstone out here, it's
freaked me out.
It's pretty
I looked
trippy.
At it and I went, oh, I don't like that.
I'm just glad it said 1990.
Like, no, I thought
I want to break it with a big sledge.
Yeah! Yeah! Beat it! Yo! Yeah! Get it out! Woo!
Woohoo!
Yeah! Put some
edge, please.
You don't need to work out
tonight. That felt good.
I was doing this thing called the couch tour, okay? And it was like getting down to, I was like squatting in this apartment. And I had like one day left. And the phone was getting turned off. And they're going to make sure that, you know, we always have your number. And I was just like, I had no money, no food, nothing to drink. Like, there's no furniture in this joint, right? And so I finally got a hold of Axel and I go, dude, man, it's like, you know, tomorrow there's not going to be a place to get a hold of me. And, you know, quite frankly, man, I'm like, I was starting to give up hope, you know, on the LA scene, the LA life. It was just like getting really tough.
I'm in a band on Capitol Records called Blind Melon.
The next day I got a call, said, dude, congratulations, you're in the band.
And you're like, nah, I don't think I can make it.
I said, let me sleep on that.
When we first wrote the song, it was the first song written for Guns N' Roses.
Watch you stand up and turn around and see that.
This is the attire, folks, right here.
Actually, we weren't Guns N' Roses yet, but, you know, it was starting to become a reality. And Izzy and I wrote a song and decided we needed to get back together.
And it was something said to you. It's not you, the original.
Yeah, it was a girl that Izzy had gone out with. You know, she's tattooed on my arm.
Right here. And these are my detasseling overalls.
And I was really attracted to her, and they split up. And when we wrote that song, which was like our most Hanoi Rocks influenced song, we knew we had something.
I think it all just has to do with just a hope, you know? You can't give up hope, and you can't give up, you know, your dreams.
Everyone's like, I'm in the jungle, or I'm in the, you know, It's So Easy, or I'm in the Sweet Child. And I was like, I'm in the Don't Cry. People are like, what? I'm like, nah, it's just this cool song. I'm like, okay.
Yes.
What's your nickname, Sam?
God of Thunder and
what else?
Cement Underwear. Rice Bird. Is this a Kawasaki? No, I can't do this.
That's funny. Got it. That's fine.
I was sitting outside the Roxy, and, you know, I was like really in love with this person, and she was realizing this wasn't gonna work. It wasn't, she wanted to do other things, and she was telling me goodbye, and I like sat down and just started crying, you know, a bit, you know, and she was telling me don't cry.
Giving up is too easy, you know. It's something I always wanted. I never actually thought that I would be in the past, you know, but I mean, 6 years later, here I am.
Next night we got together and wrote the song in 5 minutes.
And that was a girl that he had been with before you.
Yeah, you know, and he had been through some things with her and stuff, and so we had another form of common ground.
Axel always told me something about how they wanted to wait.
you know, because it was such like the mega song. And he's also said it's the song that got him signed.
We'd open for speed metal bands, and we do all our fast songs, but we do Don't Cry, and these guys with spikes all the way up their arms, they come up and love that song.
No, I didn't do anything on the studio. But it sounds great live.
It sure does.
It sounds awesome.
The first big Guns N' Roses.
Yeah. Forum.
So,
yeah.
And you tripped out?
I was very tripped out. I'd only been in front of like a... Aside to the Pantages, I didn't have time to get nervous at that because it was just real spontaneous. But at the Forum, man, I was blown away.
Give me a kiss before you tell me goodbye. Don't you take it so hard now. And please don't take it so bad.
I was so scared. My knees were really shaking.
I thought this song had any like metaphoric thing in connection with LA. You know, what do you think that would be? Just off the top of your head.
Off the top of my head, from experience.
Yeah.
A love life in Los Angeles is pretty much non-existent.
You can look back behind you too for a little thought impetus.
Don't cry. It's only LA. It could be worse.
I remember Axe and Slash both talking about recently, Don't Cry to them really ends up retrospectively being a real LA song for them.
I think I was just really, really fucking nervous, and it got the best of me. It kind of shook me up, but I learned a lot that night.
A whole new set of words for the verses and a melody for these words started happening while I was singing the other parts. I started hearing this stuff in my head, and I was like, Mike, put me on another track. And he's like, what? And I go, I don't know, just, I gotta go with this. It's too strong to stop.
Hearing the new version was a stone cold trip for me, because you're like singing the words along to words that aren't happening, and then you feel stupid.
I prefer the new version because the original is, you know, it's kind of like a nostalgia piece for me. That takes me through like the history of Guns N' Roses and everything. When
and it's
I hear
reflective
the song.
On LA too.
Yeah, and everything I've been through in LA.
Remember the first time Axl played it, I was like, what?
Does it trip you out?
Yeah, it does trip me out. They're really cool.
It doesn't trip me out to hear it because I played on it.
It pops on the radio now, and I don't know which one it is until the words come in, so it's always like this hetchy sketchy guess.
The first few times, I was like, kind of skeptical, but now I really love it.
The band didn't even quite realize it until, you know, we were playing it in recording the performance footage for this video. We did the old one a few times, and when we did the new one, everybody just cut loose, and we rocked so much harder because it's where we are now.
I love the song. I always have. Well, dude, these are the cousins of that bird from the night when Axl was the Hulk.
This is Larry Bird.
When we were under the grave that night, there was that bird.
He wants a meal penalty.
Whoa,
he's been working.
Goes
there he
bird.
Goes. Hit. He got it. He wanted to eat. We didn't want to pay him a meal penalty.
Whoa, dude.
That's all right. Everyone in this whole set has been shitting on me.
Dizzy, who wrote Don't Cry, man?
I did.
It's a good song, dude.
Thanks.
And I just wonder what if you're tripping off Izzy not being here.
No, I'm not really tripping off it right now because I'm just like, Izzy's cool. You know, Izzy's always been the fastest person in Guns N' Roses to decide what it is they want to do and what it is they're going to do. And so, you know, whatever Izzy's doing or whatever he's not doing is cool. I, you know, just want the guy to be happy. And that makes me feel happy, you know, makes me feel good inside.
I try and feel the sunshine, but you bring the rain. You try and hold me down with your complaint. You cry and moan and complain, you want a tear.
This scene is going to be like a real bitch to do because the other scenes were a lot easier because with makeup
and everything, it was a lot easier to get into character. The fact that this situation, this scene is pretty close. You know, it's somewhat of a dramatized reenactment of something that really happened.
That move, the move, and the height.
Perfect.
Yeah.
She's vicious.
Okay,
you guys, come on. Let's get this happening. We have nothing in the camera.
It is.
Yeah. The camera stays there.
So it's really hard emotionally to do it and to put myself in that place and to think about it, because I was really upset that day. The room here and stuff is nothing like where I lived. But it's what we could get to do this. It looks cool. It's fine. We're making the best of it. Might as well not establish it with anything of my stuff, because it's like nothing in here is anything of my stuff, so it's like doesn't really fucking matter. So when I first got here tonight, I saw it, and I was just like, this blows, I want the fuck out of here. Every scene is getting completely different than what we sat down and talked about, so I'm loving it.
Chuck made this.
Yeah.
Painted this.
Chuck made this Oni. Chuck made Oni.
He painted that jacket. And
the laser. The laser, not a real photo.
That's right.
Josh's call.
Call.
Watercolors.
Gosh, okay. And and what we're doing, we're going to do for another 15 minutes so Andy loses his mind.
Stephanie? Next to you.
What's it like working with your boyfriend?
It certainly makes things a lot nicer. I mean, I'm a lot happier when he's around. I think he's a lot happier when I'm around.
Have you ever had to do a scene like that has that much, physical stuff involved?
No, I've never had to do a scene before. But it was it was weird because we've never fought.
You and Axel?
Never.
Is it weird?
Not even, I mean, especially not physically, but never even verbally, or we've never had a disagreement.
Wow, that's heavy. Seriously, I mean, I watch you guys and you both look so vicious in that fight. It's pretty strange,
It's fun.
To see it, because I know you don't
fight. I like to see that side of him.
Axel, we were just talking about how you guys were doing a fight scene, but yet you and Stephanie don't fight. Is that true?
Oh yeah, it's really wild. Last night was very strange because it was like, I don't want to be next to this person with this attitude to me. I don't care who she is.
Oh, that's right. She's never dealt you any of that attitude like she did in the bar scene.
Oh man, it was gnarly.
Now spin him around to the top.
Yeah, realism.
Are you okay?
Fuck yeah. No, I hit my back on that.
And now,
she kicked my ass.
And now it's
better hear. Mine than yours.
Josh, who wrote Don't Cry?
I did. Andy, what did you think of me and us and our project when I met you in New York City that night, many months ago?
I thought you were joking.
What do you mean?
Well, you asked me what I thought. I thought you were joking.
That we wanted you?
Yeah, I thought it was the funniest thing I've ever heard in my life.
You told me you loved our storyboards.
I did. I wanted the gig.
You did?
Yeah.
Just because it was Guns N' Roses?
Yeah.
What was your favorite thing you had never done that you got to do this time around?
Car crash.
Okay.
Over the side of the cliff.
Yeah, that first one was really nice. Did you guys have that on film?
Yeah. I remember that moment.
I got to the set and he's like, it wasn't brilliant.
It was, kind of went over the edge in 20 feet. Yeah.
And they dragged the car back and then it rocked the next time, which was quite cool.
Yeah, it was great.
That was out of control, man. Warhand, tell him.
Cun! You can't use it, you cun!
That was excellent, fantastic. It was cracker, sir.
It's like cunt, Daniel, you can't use it.
Or I could
stop trying to plot against a documentary! We just put a car over a cliff!
Look at Augie Donatelli on camera, ladies and gentlemen. That's our documentary cameraman. What'd you think of that, Augie?
It was...
Robert!
Whatever you say, you big psycho.
He's like the guy in Science of the Lambs. He's like, put the lotion in your basket.
So Slash, you didn't get hurt. You didn't get hurt.
There's no pressure on, but we need to enjoy that for a
while. Yeah, let's do it again.
Yeah.
Friday, I haven't seen her since.
Huh?
I haven't seen her since.
Well, you know, I think she's down there just hanging.
Now, was motion control fun the other night?
Yeah, it was great.
It's the fastest shot we did.
Especially after 21 hours.
The scene we did the other night was originally written with Izzy in it. You know, and he didn't want to be here. So we had to improvise, you know, and we changed the way the room looked. Anyway, that was just something that came up.
And action!
Hey, Holmes, you just chill.
The one in that door is watching this person and the person in bed argue, or?
No, the person in bed is watching these two people in doorways argue.
Two different doorways. One person here.
One standing right here in the foreground. Here's the door. Back.
Arguing with this guy.
Yeah, and you'll see his reflection there also.
Right.
How do we get me in the bed at the same time?
You're there, and we see him in the
bed. Because it's emotion control. I just do it three times.
This guy's going to block this guy here. We see him in the mirror. You're looking here.
It's making sense to me now.
Yay.
Then we go. I'll tell you where we had to stand.
So in walks through the door.
Bam.
There he is. There
now he's in the foreground. Arguing here. So oh, cool. Got
all right.
It. Look at A. You
should have shown me that one.
Mapped yeah, right. You showed like, us these fucking empty beds, man. These things a lot.
Because I'm sorry. I was like going off because I just don't feel bad, dude. See it.
I think the fucking Andy and Josh did a lame job in fucking explaining it.
Dougie.
So you'll see.
Meanwhile, my mushroom run get me a spit cup. And Morahan needs the batteries on his phone recharged. Well, you've been over eating goldfish fucking crackers. I've been getting reamed by everybody here. Eh? I'm at it.
I quit. So, promise?
We have Tom Barron.
Hi.
Who created the motion control crane.
Right, we call it the Bulldog. Well, I mean, we've got a background in the special effects photography, which requires the ultra precision and repeatability.
It's the machine that they use in Star Wars, right? And they programmed to go.
Yeah, now, right. Actually, that one started out as the Dijkstraflex. The main plan there was that they were going at what we used to call go motion speeds, which are very, very slow, where you're shooting almost time-lapse photography. The whole thing was fairly lightweight and light duty. The whole idea of the computer interface to the motion control camera, that's been around. But having it at this speed, real-time speed, that's new. How he's going to get three or four Axl Roses
and
in there?
Why this works, why this is special.
If you watch the camera move, the camera is moving through the scene. And as it moves, it's creating more space within the frame for Axl to appear in. And what we'll do in post-production is take all of those pieces of film, layer them together, and split the frames.
Characters that I was playing were much different. You know, because it was originally written like just sitting in a hotel room kicking it, you know, and then it would change to like being in a hospital, you know, kind of like to represent a mental wore-down state and trying to work on things, you know, and then like the me of today walks, you know, that's on stage and stuff walks in, and that was supposed to be Izzy, and it wasn't Izzy, so we had to come up with that like on the spot and figure out what to do and how to make it all fit together. What was also heavy was, you know, I didn't really, you know, plan on this being completely the Axl video, you know, that it, you know, in ways it's kind of like turning out to be. So that was really hard, you know, because I want the band to be happy and, you know, everything to, you know, for us to gel and get along there. And, you know, the Izzy thing was, you know, very emotional thing because it is real and I've known him for 15 years, you know, and, he's one of the people I care about most in the entire world.
This pool scene that we're going to do tonight, you want to talk about the metaphor a little bit of Stephanie wrapped around your legs?
Well, you know, I mean, hopefully on film, she's supposed to look very peaceful. And it's like right, you
know, after the fight seems like mellowed out, and I feel like I'm being drowned by this relationship, you know, because this person has calmed down, that the gunfight thing is over, and they're completely calmed down with it, and I'm freaking out, thinking, you know, this person's at ease, and I'm still drowning in this mess I'm in.
Playback back place to the top. I can't relax.
Well, this is a relaxing shot.
Because you're just like this.
Yeah, it's peaceful, right?
It's completely peaceful. Eyes closed.
What I'm going to do is, because I haven't got the range because of the depth of the pool.
It's also, can I pull us out of this thing?
Right.
But this person is, you know, somewhat comfortable with where they're at and their agenda of things.
First take.
And there's like the whole reason I really wanted to meet you, that tat. And I'll wear your necklace for the scene. Oh, I'm gonna wear this pants, the pair of pants like that, and biker boots and that shirt around all the time now.
Dude, it looks good. It looks really good.
It looks nice on
him. You don't.
Fuck you. I don't care how I look.
Axel's all defensive already now, I like it. He like defends you and shit. Reece, stop trying to get on camera.
Yeah, like
Jesus, you fucking ham. No, that's enough at this point.
Are you really?
Skin out of the tip of my ring. He
said he's gonna push
you. That's the truth.
Make a lot of people laugh.
Yes! I didn't push you in.
I had to do it, man. It had to be done, man.
I wrote, don't cry. I wrote it, okay?
Slash was staying at the Balaj. He did a photo shoot up there with Robert John on this platform like this up at the Balaj in West Hollywood in all of our neighborhood. And he said it'd be great. And Balaj's like, good, we'll do it, no problem.
Dude, I kicked him in the ball once by accident, like before we were signed.
Dude,
I got some free, like, extra mileage. He had me fly a lot and shit.
And right when I had my knee, he stood up and came like this. And he went, oh, and I felt so bad. And he's never forgiven me.
And I'll give you a trip to Bellevue. It's in New York City.
Mm-hmm. 2 days in production, like, and we can't let you go up there without too many people up there to film.
It's not a problem. I'll go there and make sure your room's ready.
Shit!
This is really hard because we're playing along with the song.
You know what?
That's a great jacket, dude.
It's like lip syncing, but you're actually doing it.
I want him to just film all around him.
What's up with the spit dribbling, bruh?
You're sick, dude.
It's just not like going on stage with a tape and like just moving your mouth. I'm actually singing. It's a bitch.
And sure enough, everyone got cool with it. And once we realized we could get a building down here with all this killer scenery in the background, and we were gonna go for sunset, but Mother Nature's on my dick at this time. We got a little haze today. It just came about.
What about taping it in there? Or you like the idea of taking it in and out?
It has to be able to take
it's
it
not the same thing. You know, it's something.
Yeah, it won't fit on that part.
I just broke it.
I did it.
I just broke it. It's what I have everywhere.
I understand
anything other than, and it's like stupid not having this on the chorus, you know, but like in solos and shit, I fucking use this thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I use it in the beginning of the podcast.
No, it's something I use, you know.
Why isn't it good?
You know, you go to grab the mic and put the mic in it, it ain't happening.
I'll come over to fucking Shannon's and I'll sing it. My word, sing the first.
It might work?
Yeah. Well, it's definitely going to work like that anyway, so...
Okay.
Does
Dave
have
any other ones?
All right, if you want...
Has anybody up here got a pliers?
We're on!
Hey!
Hey!
Cool.
Andy,
scratch that shit.
Yeah.
You still need those pliers?
Yeah, sure do.
We're on!
Question. All right.
Oh, okay.
You may not make it in.
All right.
live performance in helicopters. Yeah, it's very self-indulgent, extremely self-indulgent. So self-indulgent, I'm going to film three versions of myself tonight. Izzy and Axel.
Let's see yours.
Yeah, they are real.
Shannon, who wrote Don't Cry?
Man, I was on a four-way and I was down at Venice, staggering around like a zombie on a Sunday afternoon. And I seen this poor kid, he's just in this.
You know who wrote Don't Cry?
We're gonna go high at all.
Who you gonna sell this tape to, man?
But you get that fucking thing.
Oh, I mean, I wrote the song.
I wrote it like about 8 years ago. And I tried to find a gnarly crowd of people that would look good singing it. A crowd of people that didn't have a sensitive side to them. And they needed a real easy song, a real nice and heart-throbbing song, and this band was perfect.
Just got a question for you.
Yes, Dad.
So about tampons.
Are you guys going to share your profits with us?
Most definitely.
We could buy some more film stock for our documentary crew with half your profit.
Ask you again, so I'm gonna go. Oh, okay. What is that, muskrat?
Yeah. Yeah, because we. Hello. Okay, say it again.
We're gonna just puke when they see this.
Oh, God.